Hi, everyone. I'm the Vice President of Marketing for Berkeley Executive Education. My name is Lisa Ryan, and I want to welcome you to this webinar session. We're thrilled to have you take part. And on behalf of the team, I also want to thank you for being in what is our fifth week now of our series called Leading Through Crisis. This is the first of our live session webinars. So thank you again. We're very excited. And now I want to introduce our speakers today. It's Professor Laura Kray and Carolyn Buck Luce. Laura Kray is a tenured professor and the Nat and Carol Speaker Chair in Leadership at Berkeley Haas School of Business, where she has been on the faculty since 2002. Laura is an expert on the role of gender stereotypes and mindsets about gender on workplace behavior, including negotiations, leadership, and ethical decision-making. Professor Kray is the faculty director of Berkeley Haas's Center for Equity, Gender, and Leadership, and the faculty director of our program in executive education, Women's Executive Leadership Program. Carolyn Buck Luce is co-founder and managing partner of the boutique consulting firm Imaginal Labs. She has been a leader in both the private and public nonprofit sectors for the last four decades and has spent her career building highly effective cultures, businesses, teams, and leaders. Her career journey has provided her with a unique perspective on building the culture, leadership behaviors, and systems that drive creativity and innovation. A big thank you to both of our presenters. And now I would like to turn it over to Laura Kray.
Thank you so much, Lisa. I want to welcome everybody to this inaugural webinar on women's leadership in the time of coronavirus. Over the past two decades, I've had the pleasure of teaching and learning from literally thousands of you from across the globe who've come to Berkeley in search of leadership lessons grounded in women's lived experiences, as well as cutting-edge science. This spring, due to the pandemic that has upended our lives, the in-person offering of women's executive leadership was not possible. Despite our physical distance, it has never been more important that we adapt and find new ways of supporting each other. The fact that you have shown up here today speaks volumes to the incredible community of forward-leaning and generous leaders that you are. Thank you, and thank you to Berkeley Executive Education for making this virtual convening possible. As for me, I'm sheltering in place at home in Berkeley with my very sweet 16-year-old cat. He's a bit camera shy and sleepy, but if we're lucky, he just might pay us a visit. The other more certain guest today that I'm excited to introduce is Carolyn Buck Luce, a pioneer in the space of women's leadership who embodies the wisdom, power, courage, and compassion of which she speaks. She's one of the 100 women leaders profiled in Joanne Barsh's classic book, How Remarkable Women Lead, and she's here today to share the secret sauce. She was the very first person who came to mind when I considered inviting a guest. And if you have not already had the chance to be in her presence, it will soon become apparent why. Thank you, Carolyn.
Well, it's a pleasure. Thank you. It's one of my favorite things to do every year is to help kick off the Women's Executive Leadership Program at Berkeley. So I'm here sheltering in place in San Rafael, California, and happy to be with you.
Thank you. Okay, so let's begin and review our agenda for the next hour. Today, we're going to explore three themes that speak to sort of short-term, medium-term or ongoing-term, and then longer-term goals. In the short-term, effective coping or self-care is absolutely critical. You know how they say to put on your own oxygen mask before helping others? Well, it could never be truer than it is today. Recognizing this fact, we'll begin by exploring evidence-based approaches for managing stress. This includes fostering social connections, making sense of this crisis and what it means for our lives, and by maintaining a positive outlook for the future. once these urgent needs are met, then it's important to monitor and develop strategies to get into the right frame of mind to handle and deal with this change at home and at work. When change is upon us, growing pains are inevitable. You need not be overwhelmed if you stop resisting, though, and stop trying to prove that you know all the answers. This is true for all of us, including myself. This means flexing our growth mindset muscles and giving up outdated, fixed ways of doing things that no longer fit our current reality. The pandemic has made clear how critical it is that we work together, and we will explore strategies for collaboration suited for both physical and virtual worlds, and fundamentally grounded in a feeling in the air of psychological safety. Finally, we will touch on some strategies for keeping our dreams alive and continuing to pursue what matters most to us. By acknowledging our own power and recognizing that some of our power derives from a willingness to work with and not against vulnerability, we will be in the best position to usher in a world that, in the words of Carolyn, is better, fairer, and safer for all. So I'm going to turn now to Carolyn and ask that you speak to us on the raw ingredients needed to be a remarkable woman leader.
Great. So what I want to present here is a model that was actually developed by Joanna Barsh at McKinsey, maybe 15 years ago, that came from studying 100 remarkable women to see what was the commonality, what were some of the universal traits of women who were remarkable, remarkable in their leadership, both at home, at work, in the world. And there are five areas, and I want to touch on each of them. And I want you to think about what actually this means in these amazing times that we're in, totally unimaginable times. The first is meaning and purpose. You know, there's been so much conversation about what creates purpose. My simple definition is, what is your theory of change about how the world gets better that you believe that you are uniquely called on to make your own contribution in your own way? The ability to really be animated by meaning and purpose, and not just in the future, but to actually know that every day you have actually everything you need, resource rich or resource poor, to have a day of meaning and purpose, the ability to discover meaning for yourself and create meaning for others every single day. That's meaning for centered leadership. The second sphere is around managing energy. How do you actually be in flow? And, I've recently been in a conversation with Dr. Zach Bush, an amazing doctor, environmentalist, spiritual teacher. And he talked about how women have this amazing ability to be in flow, to be able to recognize that everything is horizontal and relational, and to think as much about process as they do about goals. And so the ability to manage your energy, know how to do self-care, know how to work hard, play hard, know how to rejuvenate yourself. That's what I mean about managing energy. The engaging is about engaging with your own truth, your own voice, and actually being able to step up and know that it's not that life is happening to you, that you can make life happen for yourself and others, and to really be in your truth, in your authenticity, with your real voice. The connecting piece is about the reciprocal nature of relationships, the ability to know that to love comes from caring, and that the ability to create networks, even at this time of isolation, where we not only connecting head to head, but we know how to connect heart to heart and hand to hand, and to do it not for yourself, but for the benefit of others. And then the last piece, which is so important now, is the ability to do positive framing. You know, I was born sunny side up. I am lucky. My husband says he was born butter side down. But here's what I know about positive framing. Everyone can learn optimism. And that is to be able to say, whatever's happening, it's not happening to me. It's happening for me. So how can I use this opportunity, whatever it is, to be able to invest in meaning and purpose and think about where do I go from here? So these are sort of the elements of centered leadership that all the women in McKinsey study had in common. Over to you, Laura.
Thank you so much, Caroline. Yeah, it's such a timeless model and just resonates on such a deep level. I think we all can intuit how important each of these elements are to really be standing in a place of, you know, centeredness and authenticity. So let's turn to the next slide, please. And I just want to begin with just a reminder of, you know, some of the ways in which we're all the same, men, women, gender non-binary, and some of the ways in which we have been socialized to be, you know, unique and different from each other. And so to begin, just, you know, remember what's happening and pay attention to what's happening in our bodies, right? So imagine you're out in the middle of the woods and you come upon a bear. You know, what do you do? How do you react? Well, you know your body is going to lead the way. You're either going to, you know, try and fight, or maybe you're going to try and escape, or maybe you're going to shrink and get small. And all of these are reactions that anybody may have to a very real threat in front of them, such as the pandemic that we are facing. However, it's important to know that the research that was originally done on these three different stress responses was based on 80% of the samples being male animals. And so if we turn to the next slide, we can see that the work of Dr. Shelley Taylor at UCLA, she did work where she brought in a more balanced sample, or a sample of predominantly female animals. And what she found is that there's another way of responding that is actually quite adaptive. And she calls it the tend and befriend response. So when we are in that threatening environment, we have another choice, and that choice is to tend to those who are most vulnerable, the young, the weak, the ill, the you know, anybody who needs us, and also to turn to those around us to get support. And in so doing, we get this social bonding hormone of oxytocin firing off in our bodies, and this enables us to survive. And so in females, it increases the drive to socially connect. And we know in psychology experiments, when we ask people to just fill out on a page, you know, 10 different ways of responding to the prompt, I am dot, 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 the women are more likely to define themselves in terms of their basic relationships. I am a friend, I am a daughter, right? As opposed to, you know, I am, you know, nervous. And so this self-definition as fundamentally interconnected with others is important to foster in this time of threat. So Carolyn, you're going to lead us through a very simple exercise where in this virtual environment, we can really utilize, you know, sort of the power of technology to make even more salient how fundamentally interconnected we are.
Yes, thank you, Laura. So, you know, actually, even though we're using these kinds of technologies, there is a much greater technology in the world, and that's the human being's ability to connect, to care for each other, to be in relationship, and to problem solve. How do we do that? So here's a way that I like to do it on all of these virtual chats, because I know we are all on them. So here's what I'd like you to do. Hold your hand up as close as possible to the screen. I want you to see your whole hand and see my hand and just feel the energy for a second. Now take your hand and put it on your heart and smile. Such a simple thing, just to be able to know that we are all here, we are all together, and we are here in service of each other. So.
Thank you, that's beautiful. It's a great way to get us interacting, and you will be, you know, as we move through our discussion, there are going to be several other opportunities for those of you who are live streaming on Zoom, on YouTube, to share with us your thoughts and questions. And we certainly really encourage you to offer up those, you know, those insights, because we are stronger together. So with, you know, social connection front and center, and understanding that, you know, we have to start there and we have to lean on each other in order to get through this crisis. Another, you know, really fundamental, as you illustrated in your model, another fundamental, you know, aspect of coping is meaning, right? Making sense of what's going on. And I wanted to share with you a little bit of research that I've done. One of my areas of expertise is on what's called counterfactual thinking, and how when we consider alternative realities, it helps us to understand, you know, to be more analytical on the one hand, to understand cause and effect relationships more clearly, but also when applied to our personal lives, it can enable us to make sense of why things happen the way they do. And so meaning fundamentally is, you know, created by discovering positive implications, hidden benefits, how we, through this crisis, are becoming a wiser self, a self that's more in tune with what's important in the world. And so how do we do this? So this is what I've been studying, is this connection between imagining alternative worlds and seeing what effect that has on our ability to recognize, you know, sort of the downstream consequences of a catalyzing event such as this pandemic. And so to begin to sort of illustrate this, I want to encourage everybody in the audience to contribute here in our chat by just taking a minute and pausing. And, you know, we're what, 6 weeks into this pandemic, and, you know, there's no doubt this has been a very painful, excruciating experience for many of us. At the same time, there may be some positive benefits that are already emerging. And I want to give you an opportunity to identify them. And so to do so, I want you to just ask yourself, how would you be a different person today if this turning point had never occurred? So you might ask yourself, where would you be? You know, how might your most important relationships be different? How might your beliefs, values, and feelings be altered? Are there any other details about this imagined life that you can picture? So I'm going to give you a moment to think about that, and I'll share an example from my own life. And then let's see what you come up with. So, yeah, I mean, when I think about all the things, the, you know, the ways in which my spring has changed because of this pandemic, there were some really exciting trips I was going to be taking that didn't happen. So that is unfortunate. At the same time, as I mentioned, I have a 16-year-old cat who is very frail and somewhat ill. And so I know that if this turning point hadn't happened, I would not have been able to spend as much time with him at this precious moment in time than I would otherwise. Carolyn, any thoughts on how your life would be different if this turning point didn't
Absolutely.
Happen?
You know, I've been a road warrior since I've been 20, and I won't even bother to tell you how old I am now, but I have not been on a plane since I got back from Guatemala at the end of January. And I have so enjoyed actually being at home with my husband in the blooming spring of California. I feel so rested.
Yeah, and that's something that, you know, we should relish. And it's through recognizing that silver lining, right? It may, overall, if we could take it away, maybe we would. But if you could, you know, if we can identify some silver linings out of the experience, we know that that gives people a sense of meaning.
Yeah, so I'm taking a look now at what's coming in. And there's an awful lot of themes around being able to finally spend more time with family, catch up with friends, have your teenagers have to talk to you. someone else's, they would have had a lot more road rage. They've been able to let go of road rage. Another one about exercise. I'm hoping that we're all in much better condition by cooking at home, walking around. Also just a lot of the little things that otherwise been taken for granted.
I dug out an old cookbook that my friends put together for me that, you know, was filled with their favorite recipes, pictures of us together, and stories about, you know, our wild adventures in college. And I had not looked at that book or made those recipes in, you know, 25 years.
I'm so also seeing
reconnecting to that part of my life because I have the time here at home has been a gift.
I'm also seeing a theme, Laura, which is really lovely about more time using professional skills on behalf of the community in terms of people who are in need. And then of course, there's a lot of people learning how to be teachers because they're, which I think is giving us a much greater appreciation for the teaching profession.
Absolutely, yes. I mean, so if we go to the next slide, while these are still coming in, I just want to share with you. So the research part of it, so I mentioned the counterfactual, right? How would my life be different if this didn't happen? In this study, we asked people to identify a turning point in their lives. And, you know, people came up with all sorts of events. It was the day I met my future spouse. It was the day my mom died of breast cancer. It was the day, you know, my dad went to prison. So it, you know, ran the gamut of incredibly positive events and incredibly negative events. And we had people in one of three conditions. We either had them do the exercise that we just did right here, where they thought counterfactually about the turning point, or in another condition, we just said, tell me about the facts, you know, tell me about what happened, where were you when this turning point happened? Or in a third condition, we had people try to directly identify what was the meaning of the turning point. And after they went through these exercises, we measured in a self-report, you know, sort of way, a scale that we developed, how meaningful was this turning point to your life? And what you can see here, it's that through imagining that the event hadn't happened, it's there that the meaning pops. So I want to encourage you, as this continues to unfold, even as we might grieve for what we are losing and et cetera, to always, you know, train yourself to think about what, how things would be different. And we know that sort of effective regulation of emotions and, you know, the extraction of meaning, we tend to spontaneously, you know, focus on the positive benefits, the silver linings. And so you can trust this to be an effective tool. And just to, you know, if we go forward, let's go forward here on the next slide. Just to remind you of the holiday classic, It's a Wonderful Life. And many of you, I'm sure, have seen this usually around the holidays. And in this film, remember Jimmy Stewart's character, George Bailey, is saved from the depths of despair by a guardian angel who comes down to guide him through the process of imagining what life would be like if George had never existed. And by thinking counterfactually, George learns how to count his blessings. So next, please. And so just to sort of wrap up this, thinking about what we need to do in this moment to make sure that we are, compassionate with ourselves and engaging in self-care. We want to cultivate gratitude for our own wonderful lives, imperfect as they may be. Again, Shelley Taylor's research, she has studied HIV patients, women with breast cancer, looking at what people spontaneously do to adapt, right? And what predicts, sort of standard measures from physicians of patients coping. And, meaning, finding the meaning. Why is this happening? How is this, fit into my evolving narrative of my life? And we know that even painful events, as life unfolds, it becomes very difficult to imagine what our life would be like if they hadn't happened. Because through loss and hardship, we may say, I've really learned to be, sort of live more in the moment. I've learned to be a more genuine person, to really focus on what matters to me. And so that may mean lowering, the priority that we give to sort of mundane, day-to-day tasks of housework and quarrels and other people's problems, and elevating, giving higher priority to relationships with family and friends, our, personal projects, health, the enjoyment of home, and the best parts of our work. Many of us are not able right now to, be working on, at full capacity. And so to the extent that you have any choice in the matter, focus on what is the most gratifying and urgent for you. And then the other two, just to kind of go back up to the top here, the meaning is absolutely essential. And also what we find is that, maintaining a sense of control, right? What is it that you do have control over? We're all trying not to get sick. We're all trying to, shelter in place. So, focus on what are some of the things you can control and remind yourself of that, right? If I, don't go out to the grocery store every day, I'm going to minimize my likelihood of contact with the virus. And then lastly, there's this idea of maintaining self-esteem. And so again, with the cancer patients that Shelley Taylor studied, she found a remarkable tendency that no matter how bad off somebody was, what they tended to do to, bolster their own sense of self-esteem and to, carry on was to, identify people who were worse off than them and to say, while I had to have a lumpectomy, at least I'm not as hard off as, somebody who had to have a mastectomy, and et cetera. So, we all turn on the news and see all the tragedy going on in this world right now, and I'm sure many of you have had direct contact with it. It's okay to, count your blessings in terms of, that you have been spared some of the hardships so far. So let's turn to the next topic here. Thinking about change and how, this is just, we are in a transition period. And so Carolyn, can you tell us a little bit about what you have learned in your experience on leading through change?
I will. And just one more thought on gratitude. Before I do that, there's a wonderful website, gratefulness.org, and Brother David Stendelross has spent his life talking about gratitude. And what he says is, you don't have to be grateful for everything. Like, we don't have to be grateful for this pandemic. And there are many things that are hard about our lives, but we can be grateful for the opportunity that we can do something. And whether that is maintaining our self-esteem, whether it's reaching out to a neighbor, whether it's just the gratitude of being able to reflect on being empathetic with our neighbors and with our communities. So it's the gratitude that you can always make a positive choice to go deeper into meaning. I love the term gratitude.
Yeah, thank you. That's really beautiful.
I would encourage all of you to have a gratitude practice at the end of the day. Just three things that you're grateful for and share that with someone you love or text it to someone you care about.
Yeah, actually we have it built in here. Let's take a minute and just express, you know, three things that you're grateful for in this moment. Or one. Gratitude to be able to work from home. Absolutely.
Right. And keep typing those gratitudes in. You know, there's something about moving from your thinking to writing something down or sharing it. It actually moves it to a different part of your memory. It sticks more. It actually gets put into a different file. So just keep them coming. Family, husband, virtual connections, walk in the park. Someone from New Zealand, daughters in New Zealand. They're doing a great time in New Zealand, actually. They've somehow figured this out. All right. So thanks. Keep those coming. That's beautiful.
Yeah. And I would just say, you know, I'm grateful for, as some mentioned, you know, sort of the walks in the neighborhood. And I have seen and noticed, you know, some more people around me in my neighborhood than I have in the 7 years I've lived here, because you know, we're all hustle and bustle under normal times. And, you know, things are a little bit slower and you see people safely distancing, but coming out, you know, at sunset to the Rose Garden. And I'm incredibly grateful for that.
Yeah. There's two hawks making a nest in my redwood tree. So I'm grateful for them.
Wow.
All right. So now for something a little bit different, but very related. Once we actually then think about organizationally, and when I'm talking about organizationally, it doesn't have to mean your organization at work. It could mean your family organization, your community. But it's another model about leading through change. And I decided to take this one from really a wonderful work of Chip and Dan Heath in their book called Switch, How to Change Things When Change is Hard. So first, a little story. You've got a rider and an elephant. So the rider's on top of the elephant and thinking he or she is in control. Elephant's much larger, maybe by 10 times. And they're moving towards the village. Everything is calm. And all of a sudden, a snake comes up and scares the elephant. And the elephant turns around and runs smack back into the village, creating all sorts of destruction in their path. And why is that? So the rider is actually the rational mind. And it's very small compared to the amygdala that Laura was talking about, the emotional state that you have, the way you feel things. That's the elephant. And the elephant is much larger in terms of the power of those emotions than the little rational head, which is the rider. And the job of managing change is threefold. It's how do we direct the rider, the rational people that we're talking about? How do we motivate the elephant, which is capture the emotions of the people in the organization? And then how do we shape the path? And that's really dealing with the political, physical, and energetic environment that is around. So for example, how does one do that and do it simultaneously? To direct the rider, you need to be able to be clear about here's where we are and here's where we're going, current state, future state. You need to be able to script these critical moves in terms of key milestones. And you need to be able to help imagine what does goodness look like. So that's what the rider needs. And they've got the reins. But in order to be able to make sure the feeling comes with them, because change happens because people have an emotional shift. It's not here. Turns out that people actually love change. They're not afraid of change. They're afraid of failing at change. And that's an emotional and political concern in organizations. So to motivate the elephant, you need to get to the feeling. And instead of trying to raise the bar, the opportunity is to shrink the change so that you're shrinking the concern about failure. And then create a new identity, give people a different way of understanding themselves. You know, I love the two words, make believe. Do you remember what it was like when you played dress up? As soon as you put that costume on, you were someone else. You had superpowers. My 2.5-year-old grandson, his name is Lincoln, but we can't call him that. We can only call him Flash, because he's like a superhero. And he just got a new baby sister. My granddaughter is 5 days old. And so we've given Flash jobs to do using his superpowers to have lower voices when the baby cries, you know, but he's got this new identity. And then lastly, it's shaping the path. You know, a lot of times it's frustrating in change because people just don't get it. Don't blame people for their behavior of not getting it. Figure out what you can do to shift the energetic environment in order to rally people around. And I don't think there's a better example right now than watching some of our governors. You know, I'm a transplant from New York. I was 40 years in New York City. And so I get Governor Cuomo's everyday emails, but I'm also listening into Gavin Newsom's work here in California. And they are working at all those three levels. They are really directing the rider. Here's where we are. Here's where we're going. This is what goodness would look like. Here are some critical things that we need to do. They are capturing the feeling of let's be in community. Let's do this for others. All of a sudden, they are heralding new identities where our heroes now are the essential workers. Janitors are called essential workers. Imagine how that makes people committed to move the community. And then they are solving for the environment. You know, this region, this is how we're going to roll out. This is what opening will look like. They are smoothing the way. So this is, if we think about the head, the heart, and the path, those are some of the, that's a great model for leading change and something that I think women, if you are connected to both your masculine and feminine energy, so for the men who are listening, thank you for joining, and the women, when we are really connected to both our logic and our rational selves and our relational heart-to-heart selves, magic happens.
Thanks so much. That's awesome. I love the image and the metaphor. So let's turn to the next slide, please. And just, you know, all of my students know that the mindset is absolutely critical to learning and change. And I just want to remind people of your mindset is a choice, right? We have lots of control over how we, you know, sort of the filter that we adopt to experience the world and the change that is inevitable. And a lot of what Carolyn was talking about there, you know, to me resonates with this idea of a growth mindset, right? So recognizing the fear and the vulnerability is, you know, when we are faced with change, we may say, what if I fail? What does this say about me? You know, there I've gone again, you know, falling flat on my face. And if we can, you know, sort of shift into a mindset of growth and learning, all of a sudden, we're not as paralyzed by that vulnerability, right? And this is true, certainly, you know, we know a lot about the power of mindsets in educational settings. We know a lot about mindsets in the workplace and how managers who have growth mindsets are, you know, more focused on developing their employees and helping them along the way. It's also really important as this tremendous disruption is happening to our lives to look at mindsets as it relates to the division of labor within the home, right? People are working at home for the first time, in many cases working at home with a spouse who's also working at home for the first time. Many of you with children are now taking on an additional role as a teacher. And you know, all of these areas can strike fear in our hearts, right? That I'm not, you know, this is too much, I can't do it. And just remind yourself, you know, what would my growth mindset voice say here, right? Let's, you know, frame this up as a innovation opportunity, right? Let's, you know, frame this up as a way to finally make those changes that, you know, maybe we talked about early on in our relationship, but, you know, have sort of fallen into tired old patterns. So, you know, use this as an, just don't fear the change. Look at it as an opportunity to grow and look to others as role models. Take the opportunity to share with others what's working for you so you can be a role model. And don't let that fixed mindset, you know, get in your way. We know that the most valuable of human qualities is the ability to grow psychologically. And it's necessarily an ongoing process involving repeated feelings of vulnerability. And the more we can make friends with those feelings, as opposed to fighting against them, then the, you know, the easier a path we're going to have. And that takes me, you know, so I invite you all to, you know, one of my heroes is Carol Dweck, and, you know, her book on mindsets is definitely worth a read, or, you know, go back to it if you've read it before, and you may notice, you know, sort of new insights. And then the other, you know, so let's think about if you find yourself falling into the fixed mindset, what can you do to foster the growth mindset? And so want to ask you all here to, you know, take a minute and share with our, you know, community here, what do you do to help you to be in a growth mindset? Go for a walk. Carolyn, what do you do to get yourself into a growth mindset?
Well, you know, I have a little question that's always in my head, and maybe it's why I've been more of a urban gorilla all my life, which is I'm always asking the question, well, why not? Well, why can't we? So it's interesting to think about, for all of you, think about when you've done amazing things, when you've done something unique and different that you felt great about, what was going through your head when you did it? Mm. Like, what was that little voice in your head that said, wait a second, I can do this? Because chances are that that's a recording that you can choose to replay over and over, because we all have a growth mindset. It's just that we don't have it all the time. Recover, rediscover when you do have a growth mindset and get that in your head as a mantra.
We get people, they say, I'm committed to learning. I read, I ask questions.
Great.
I, you know, go for a run, stop working, you know, sort of get into my body.
Yeah. A lot of body stuff.
Yeah. Type, right.
Go for a run. Absolutely.
Right. And, you know, doing anything for the first time, heck, this webinar, right? There's a can-do attitude that is often helpful and consistent with a growth mindset. And then there's also just the self-compassion, you know, sort of how talking to yourself as you would to a young child, right? Like, even if I say something stupid, even if I, you know, sort of draw a blank, it's okay. It's okay. Right. And it's not the end of the world. And so it gives us a little bit more leeway to take some healthy risks.
Yes, I love Juliet's comment, ask for feedback.
Yes.
So, that'll keep you growing.
Yeah, absolutely. Celebrate
victories. Yay.
Yeah. chicken to the soul to reduce the pressure. Ask questions, research more. Yeah, turn to experts. All right, and so yeah, we'll keep these coming in while we move forward. On the next slide, you know, just another great book by Herminia Ibarra that, you know, how leadership is really about a growth mindset. So, you know, keep a journal, keep a diary, ask yourself, you know, we don't know how long this is going to continue. We know in California here, we're going to be sheltering in place through the end of May at least. Right. So what learning goals can you set for yourself? What do you want to pick up and try or do differently in this period of time? What new activity? Right. So again, I am not a big cook. I used to cook a lot. I haven't cooked in 20 years. I'm cooking 3 meals a day. And it's enjoyable. It's fun. It's, you know, slows me down and you know, helps me to really appreciate, you know, sort of just the bounty of food and how vital it is to our well-being. Different voices, right? So, you know, all the podcasts out there, all the, you know, Netflix, you name it, you know, find something educational and give it a try, right? You don't have to, you know, commit forever, but just expose yourself to a different voice. Different ways of doing things, experimenting. So again, taking it back to the household, maybe you and your family talk about, you know, here, this is, you know, I'm normally the one who, you know, takes the trash out, but let's shake it up. Let's all do something different and see, you know, if it fits, if it's something that you want to carry forward. Adopting a playful frame of mind, right? That's so, I mean, consistent with the optimism and how important it is. It's got to be fun, right? You've got to learn to enjoy the process. And then being okay with incremental change. We know that, you know, we're not going to transform ourselves overnight into a different person, but just take that one step in the right direction and see where it takes you. Also relevant to, you know, thinking about, you know, change and learning, you know, just one image up here, I'm sure we've all seen, you know, just incredible images of the healthcare workers and what they're doing, coming together to save lives during this time, this pandemic. And it reminds me of Amy Edmondson's research on psychological safety, which was in fact done looking at, you know, cardiac surgery teams around the operating table, learning a new minimally invasive procedure. And what she did in her research was really, you know, groundbreaking, was to look inside the head of the surgeons and what sort of assumptions were they making about the task in front of them. Did they see it as, you know, this is just a plug-in procedure, something, you know, we've been, you know, doing all along, it's just a minor tweak? Or did they truly see it as an opportunity to innovate and experiment and learn from each other? And what she found is that the surgeons who conceptualized the task as a challenge, a new opportunity, what they tended to do was to create a, you know, sort of an environment around them that encouraged people to speak up, to offer suggestions, to push back as needed, and fundamentally to collaborate so that they could learn this new procedure more quickly with fewer errors. And so if we go to the next slide, you know, I want to encourage you all to think about what you are doing as a leader with your teams to develop psychological safety. And what is psychological safety? It's something that, you know, if you got your team and asked them all, they would agree on. It's that it's okay to take some interpersonal risks here. It's okay to say, I don't know. It's okay to say, I'm here to learn from you. What do you think? It's asking good questions. It's modeling intense listening. And ultimately, it's experienced as a culture that supports learning through candor and openness. Now you may say, well, yeah, some surgeons have that, you know, je ne sais quoi, and some don't. but it's really not the right way to think about it. So because we're all capable of creating psychological safety, it's not something inherent to the individual. It's something, as Carolyn said with her metaphor of, you know, the path, right? It's about putting the raw ingredients in place so that your team feels safe to speak up. It's not about just being nice or agreeable or, you know, sort of dumbing things down by any stretch. It's about recognizing our fundamental interdependence. So on that, Carolyn, you've been hosting a number of virtual workshops already, and you know, where you have learned trial by fire on how to collaborate virtually. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so this is just a great example. My life partner and work partner, Rob Evans, we were doing a global training on how to actually design and facilitate intense collaborative work. And this was supposed to be a full week face-to-face program, and we ended up delivering it virtually. And so what we did was we collaborated with everyone, all of our participants. And what you see here is just a screenshot of our collaborative room. This is the technology of Mural backed by Google Docs. None of us had used it before, but we wanted to recreate an environment where we all felt that we were in the same room and that we could all go to all the different rooms we wanted and pick up our assignments and chat together. And what was really, this was a great example of psychological safety because we were willing to all be in the unknowing and all play with the problem so that it was a shared problem that none of us had the answer with. But what happened was it created group genius. Mm-hmm. And you see a graphical description of what that group genius, think about the excitement of being in that room, but that was what we were in together virtually. So you know you've created psychological safety if at the end the result is group genius, because every voice is heard. You're able to iterate around an issue as opposed to right or wrong, as opposed to really understanding each and everyone's experience and play with, well, what if we did it this way? Well, what if we did it that way? Well, what if we did it this way? Because the end result is group genius. So if you put psychological safety in as the conditions, it's worth it.
That's awesome. Yeah. And just the visual of, again, these healthcare teams and what they're doing, you know, there's no BS, right, in those environments. It's, you know, let's figure this out. Let's try this. How about this? And a tremendous degree of humility. So that's awesome. Let's turn to in the interest of time, you know, we want to also touch on, you know, sort of the long term, the long game, right? We see here, you know, there are plenty of opportunities as well as challenges that women leaders in particular are facing. So on the one hand, we see really amazing, you know, sort of examples of women leaders who are stepping up and managing this crisis in, you know, in really admirable ways. On the right hand of the screen, you can see there's also, you know, some emerging evidence that, you know, women's careers are taking a hit, right? And we all know the reasons behind that. So how do we, you know, in light of the very real sort of day-to-day struggles that we're all facing in terms of, you know, taking on new responsibilities, how can we think about, you know, sort of stamina and ambition in this time, Carolyn? Let's go to the next slide.
Yeah, so this is my favorite model of all time. And it comes from the work of Anna Fels, a friend of mine, a psychiatrist in New York, who wrote a book called Necessary Dreams, Ambition in Women's Changing Lives. And instead of ambition being a dirty word, think about it more as a desire to accomplish. So my bet is all of you have children or were children once. Mm-hmm. Now, remember this. Mommy, look at me. Look what I can do. That's the human being's desire to accomplish. And that's all ambition is. It's, as Laura said, it's a growth mindset. And here's the good news. Ambition is just a function of two things. Mastery, the ability to gain experiences, gain knowledge, gain skills, build mastery, and recognition, being recognized in a positive way for the mastery that you are achieving. And the challenge for women is when we allow old stories, negative recognition, to reflect on our commitment to mastery, guess what happens? Ambition begins to fall. But if we choose not to listen to those voices, but listen to the voices who know, listen to the voices who really do recognize your mastery, then you're willing to actually strive for more mastery. And guess what? Ambition grows. So this is either a vicious cycle, if you're going to play someone else's game, or it's a virtuous circle, if you're willing to play your game and take responsibility for your growth mindset, your desire to accomplish, because it has meaning and because you can create meaning. So I want to, if there was one thing you take away from anything I said, own your ambition, claim your ambition, love your ambition, and do what it takes to keep your ambition high, even when it's difficult.
That's awesome. Yeah, and just to, you know, sort of build on those insights, right? We know that historically society has told us that, you know, men are better suited to lead in times of crisis. And, you know, anybody who's tuning into this webinar, I hope already knows that that's a myth, right? That there's no special inherent ability that men have that escapes women leaders. It's just not true. And in fact, to the degree that we embrace what may be typically thought of as feminine power, or in some people's eyes, weakness, that, you know, we have the tremendous capacity to get through this together. And that includes, you know, being in touch with vulnerability. If women have historically had less power and less status than men, then that means we've experienced vulnerability. And we're in touch with it in a way that enables us to be authentic, to be in a growth mindset, to say, I need your help. And the empathy, right, through interconnection that we have fostered is absolutely an essential source of power. The time is ripe now to move beyond zero sum to get to win-win, right? And that means at times dropping the power game, right? So this isn't about power. This is about, you know, I'm not going to fight you. I'm asking for your help. And oftentimes by saying that, other people are willing to soften their stance and figure out what you have in common, right? We all want to get through this. We all want to see our, you know, the people who are ill to recover. We want our children to grow into a better future. Figure out what matters most to you and be willing to compromise, to let go of things that are less important. So I would leave you. Carolyn, were you going to?
Yeah, just one more thought about power.
Yeah.
I love power.
I do too.
But it power for the right purpose. And, you know, we are actually, as a human species, looking at the most important decade of human history is coming up. And it's going to require everyone's power. But to be powered on behalf of each other, to be powered to make a world that works for everyone. And I'm really excited about that. I'm really excited about us all playing the long game and being as powerful as possible, but all for the right purpose.
That's awesome. Yeah, I mean, we are all, everything is happening, I guess, as it should. And every single one of us is absolutely critical to getting you know, to the next phase. And so tapping into your ambition, what gets you out of bed and, you know, makes you want to, you know, sort of exert energy and take risks and speak up. And that's what you want to keep, you know, feeding and making sure that it is, you know, alive and well in you. And so we're seeing here, you know, maintaining my dreaming, keep dreaming on the vision. All of this is what, you know, we need to do. I maintain hope that feeling gives me strength to face everything. That's, you know, these are just eternal truths. And I encourage you to share them with each other. And just last slide, just to remember that, you know, as Anais Nin said, and then the day came when the risk to remain tight in a bud was greater than the risk it took to bloom. And I hope that through this short little webinar that we have, you know, reinforced for you ideas that are already, you know, sort of inherent and offered new insights and, you know, created, strengthened our community. I want to thank Carolyn for your amazing contributions. And it's just such a pleasure to get to work with you. Thank you very much.
Ditto.
Yeah.
Stay safe, everyone. Stay well. Stay grateful.
Right. Look forward to seeing you back on campus when this is all over.
And a huge thank you to you, Laura, and to you, Carolyn. It was a very relevant and hugely meaningful presentation. Thank you. And thanks to everyone who took part in this webinar session. We will have a recorded version of it posted in about a week on our Leading Through Crisis page. So please come there if you'd like to have another look at it, or if you'd like to share out, please, we encourage you to do that as well. Thank you all again. Take good care.
Bye-bye.